resides with the people, but we delegate a certain amount of that power directly to government.
Well, why would we delegate any power at all to government?
Why, only enough
to perform the duties that we have all collectively said that they would do, and nothing more. See, I look at this and I think, wow, this is brilliant, really. This whole framework is fantastic because it understands that in my private sphere of operation, I have inherent rights that cannot be violated, even if the majority of you came together and said, well, we took a vote, David, and you can't say what you want to say. No, I have individual rights that can't be taken away by government or by public action. You see, the Constitution doesn't create rights. The Constitution recognizes rights, inherent inalienable rights. And may I say, those rights exist, and don't get alarmed. Ready?
Uh-oh.
See that? See what that is? That's my belly button. And I want to invite all of you, if you're too shy to check right now, go home tonight. Check and see if you have the belly button. If you do, you also have core rights that cannot be violated. And it really is that profound. These are human rights, folks. Human rights that cannot be violated even by governmental action. But it doesn't end there. Too many times our sisters and brothers in the libertarian philosophy only focus on individual rights, private rights, and they forget that there is a public component. That, you know, the constitutional framework is brilliant because it understands the protection of individual private rights and that there is a communitarian ethos, that there's a public ethos, that the way that this is supposed to operate is that we're supposed to collectively decide how we want our society to operate, then we charge government with and our representatives to go about creating those structures, but those structures can never violate anybody's individual human rights. You see how that operates? Isn't that beautiful? I actually think this is brilliant. I love it. We should try that in this country. This would work. And I'm not even joking, y'all, because this has never been tried in the United States, because before I go one second further waxing poetic about how beautiful the U.S. Constitution is, time out. Somebody tell me what year the U.S. Constitution is either drafted in secret convention or ratified. Nicely done, Scott. Man, Scott's scooping up all the bonus points over here, y'all. If you ever play Trivia Pursuit, you want this brother on your team. 1789. Why do I bother to put the date of the founding of this country and the creation of the U.S. Constitution up here? Because now I have another question for you. Y'all remember what legal personhood means? The ability to assert rights under law? Now let me ask you a question. If that's the case, and we're so proud of we the people, who got to be legally a person in 1789?
White males.
White males who owned property or land. So let's do this one at a time. You had to be white. Literally, if you're not white, you do not get to claim to be a person under law. And you have to be male. So if you don't have a penis, literally, you are not legally a person. And you have to own land or property. If you don't own sufficient property, even if you're a white man, you're still not legally a person. Another way to ask this question is, in 1789, what percentage of the adult human beings living in the creation of the United States of America were legally persons? What percentage? 15%? 10%? 20%?
2%.
3%? Oh my God, woman, don't be so cynical.
It's 5%. Literally, 5 to 7% of all of the adult human beings were literally persons under this framework. Another way to say it, of course, that means 93 to 95% of the adult human beings were not legally persons. So another way to say this is that the founding of this country is really a founding violence, isn't it? For all this beautiful language, and it is beautiful, for all these beautiful concepts, and these are beautiful concepts. You know, that creation myth is fantastic, but it is a myth. Because in its application, and the original founding of this country, it's a founding violence, obviously, against the indigenous human beings who already lived here and were subject to intentional, deliberate genocide.
Right? We gotta tell that truth. And not, by the way, I'm not interested in telling the truth so I can wallow in guilt. I have no interest in liberal guilt at all. I'm interested in telling the truth because I believe what Nelson Mandela said, that when confronted with injustice, the only way to move past it is with a truth and reconciliation process. It has to start with the truth, acknowledging that injustice, and then it allows you to create some sort of reconciliation process to move past it. See, I'm thirsty for justice, not guilt. Right? And if we're going to have justice, we've got to start telling the truth about the injustice. And likewise, this founding of this country is a founding violence against the Africans who were brought at the barrel of a gun or the point of a spear and forced to build this country. This country was built with slave labor. The White House that Barack Obama currently occupies was built by enslaved Africans. We just got to be willing to tell that truth because it's important. And it's also a founding violence against most of the white men, right? Because most of the white men did not own enough property to be persons either. They were either indentured servants, or second-class citizens. And it's a founding violence against women. Because it's not just that women couldn't vote. I mean, women couldn't own property. Women were property. By any reasonable understanding of that word, women were property. They existed through the relationship with the men in their lives. You know, in fact, this is such an important concept that no less an authority than the late great historian Howard Zinn, may the goddess rest his soul. Yeah, right on. Howard Zinn said, history can be looked at in a number of different ways. Perhaps the most important way for American history to be looked at is as a series of struggles by actual living, breathing human beings to be legally defined as persons under the Constitution with rights. Wow. Right? And we think about it that way, it's like, oh man, this is all, like for me, this kind of like, yes, this is making sense now. And here's the thing, some people might say, all right, Cobb, you got a scathing indictment against imperialism of 500 years ago. But hey man, women can vote, we got to live to slavery, it's all good. To which I like to say, au contraire, mon frere. Because it's time to reintroduce the idea of the corporation in our little framework here. Because if this framework is helpful, and I hope it is helpful, does this make sense, what we said so far? I've seen a lot of head shaking. So this makes sense. If this makes sense, and if I'm correct that there is a difference between being sovereign and subordinate, if I'm correct that there's a difference between private and public, if I'm correct that there's a difference between rights and duties, and I am, then we should ask, well, where would we put a corporation on this framework? Well, in order to answer that question, I'll ask this question. Do y'all know what it takes to create a corporation in California today? It's actually very easy. Send it. File some papers and pay some money. That's right. Check the boxes. Make sure the name is correct. And as long as your form, you have dotted the I's and crossed the T's and your check cashes, the Secretary of State will literally rubber stamp that form and issue what? A charter. And that charter will literally create a corporation. Here's a question. How long will that corporation last? Forever. As long as you pay your filing fees, it literally can last forever. Oh, by the way, what can you do with a corporation under California law?
Limit liability.
Well, that's what it does. So you can limit liability, but even deeper, sister, the California Corporation Code says you can do anything that is legally permissible. And some of us say, well, if I'm paying attention, apparently you can do a whole lot of illegal shit and get away with it too. So the reason I point this out is that what you see is that it is incredibly easy to create a corporation. The mechanics are easy. It can live forever. You can do virtually anything with it. And that's part of the reason why these corporations have become such dominant institutions. But now I'm going to ask you this question. What do you know in 1789 what it took to form a corporation? Watch this. You had to get a bill introduced in the lower house of your state government, and that bill had to go up and pass by a majority. Then that same document had to go to the state senate, and it had to pass by a majority, and then the governor had to sign it. Does that sound like anything we know of today? a law, right? That's like passing a law. Has anybody in this crowd like me worked to either create or repeal a law? Anybody? Really, am I the only one? Yeah, over here, this brother is raising his hand. What, you're not sure? All right, raise it up. Let me ask you, brother, how hard is it?
It's hard.
It's real hard, right? It's real hard. And here's the thing. Not only was it real hard to create a corporation, the mechanics of it, but as you made the application, you had to identify an existing public need that was not being met either by private business or by existing governmental institutions. And if you were given the privilege of that corporation, not the right, you didn't have a right to incorporate. If you were granted the privilege of that corporation, all you were able to do was that very public need that had been identified. And if you were ever found to act outside of it, do you know what happened to your corporate charter? It was dissolved. Exactly. The corporate charter could be revoked. Oh, and by the way, how long could your corporate charter last? Like 5 years, 10 years? It was limited. It was very limited. By its own definition, a corporate charter was limited. And at the end of that time period, what happened? It dissolved by its own terms. Oh, and by the way, if you were ever, even if you were doing what you said you would do, even if you were in the very limited time period, if you ever acted outside the public interest, what happened to your corporate charter? It was revoked. The corporate death penalty would be imposed upon you. You know, another way to ask this question is this. If it is true that it takes an act of state government to issue articles of incorporation to give the privilege, not the right, but the privilege of limited liability, if that corporate charter can describe the duties of what the corporation is allowed to do, if that corporate charter can be held accountable and subordinate to the entity that created it, if it can only exist, as I say, a corporation should properly only exist if it's acting within the public interest, properly understood should be on this side of the line. You see how important that is? Because here's the thing. When the U.S. Supreme Court comes waltzing in an act of supreme judicial activism and says, oh no, we're going to simply say that a corporation should be considered actually a person with rights under law, it perverts this whole framework. Corporate personhood or corporate constitutional rights is not just a stupid idea, which it is. It's not just illogical, which it is. Corporate personhood is not just legally indefensible, which it is. Corporate constitutional rights is a linchpin for how the ruling elite have been able to hijack our entire country. It's not going to, you can applaud that.